question that I constantly keep asking myself, and what is very surprising for me is that I've been asking this question to myself right from infancy. Similarly, as we develop as individuals at each stage of our life, we keep asking these questions to ourselves in a similar fashion, which actually forms the people we are, our personality, and our social relationship with others. My topic today is social development across the lifespan. My name is Karen D'Souza, and I'm the Development Director for Education at Make a Difference. So I thought I would tell you a story about myself as to why am I even exploring this topic. So I've been an educator for 7 years now, and this is how I started my experience with 72 kids. And my main interest has always been into literacy and focusing on how do you motivate kids in low-income backgrounds. However, I do want to be in this sector for a long period of time, and now I've come to realize that it is essential for me to know about human development. And social development is one facet of human development, and that's the reason I have chosen this topic. This presentation is a culmination of all my readings so far. The topics that I will be covering today is, one is stages of social development. 1 minute, can you just refresh the PPT, is that possible? So there are three topics that I will be covering today in my presentation. The first is, what is social development? Just a definition, which will give you some brief idea about it. Then we'll explore and deep dive stages of social development. And at the end, a small piece on what are the factors that contribute to social development. What is social development? Social development includes socially interactive skills, social understanding and empathy, friendships, play and leisure skills, personal and social independence, and socially appropriate behavior that an individual portrays through life. So it is basically a gamut of social behavior, social interaction, and social skills. Yeah? So we've gone through this, now we go to the next stage, which is the stages of social development. Today we will be exploring one widely known and accepted theory by Erik Erikson, which actually talks about the stages of psychosocial development. This theory is basically broken up into 8 parts of human development, right from infancy to adulthood. And during each of these stage, the individual goes through a psychosocial crisis, which leads to a positive or negative social development. Positive or negative social development. It is called a psychosocial crisis because the individual over here is at conflict with the needs of the society. And each stage is basically characterized by 2 very contrary emotional forces, which are called dispositions. And they may not necessarily be completely negative or positive. For example, trust versus mistrust. Yeah. So there is not. It's not completely beneficial to have complete trust or complete mistrust. There needs to be a fine balance between both of that. And as we go through each of the stages, we will explore this. Now, these stages that are there, it is said that if a person does not complete this one stage successfully, it may hamper his success in the other stage. However, one person can always go back and develop through the stage. Okay? The first stage that we will go through is trust versus mistrust. The question that is asked by the infant between the ages of 0 to 2 years is, can I trust the world? The world is very unknown to the child, and they heavily rely on the caregiver for nourishment and safety. Okay. Nourishment and safety. They also look for consistency and care from the caregiver. Now, if this care is predictable, reliable, chances are the person will trust the caregiver, and they will use this trust across all different relationships that they have. However, if the care is unpredictable, unreliable, and inconsistent, they will develop a mistrust towards the caregiver, and they will carry this mistrust to other relationships as well. Now, as I told you, that there needs to be a fine balance between trust and mistrust. If a parent is very overindulgent, they will give them a false perception of what trust looks like. For example, if a parent is overindulgent towards an infant will automatically start crying if they don't see the parent around. But the parent needs to find a balance on how can I provide trust to the infant. But at the same time, if the parent is not around, they should be able to handle themselves for some time. Okay? If an infant succeeds that the, at this stage he gets a sense of hope. A sense of hope, why? So that when he or she gets into a crisis situation, he or she knows there will always be a support of people who will always be there for him or her. Okay? The next stage is that of autonomy, which is shame and doubt. This happens to a toddler between the ages of 2 to 4, and the question they constantly ask themselves is, can I be myself? Here the toddler tries to do things independently, like change clothes, tries to throw a ball, and the parents should provide an encouraging environment while still creating a culture of tolerating failure. For example, if a child is building blocks, a parent should not directly go and intervene and help the child, but at least give the child a chance to be successfully complete the task at hand, or let the child seek for help. This will make the child independent and also make the child feel that in case of consistent failure, I have somebody around me who will support me. When a child is successful at this stage, the child develops will. Will that it makes him feel secure and confident. However, if a child is not successful at this stage, he will feel inadequate and completely dependent on others. As we spoke about that balance, right, between autonomy versus shame and doubt, always remember, if children are given all the autonomy of the world, they may become very impulsive and they may do actions without considering people around them, and it can also lead to compulsion. And compulsion here has been described as the attempt to perfection without really understanding how are you feeling with constant failure. Yeah. The third stage that we will go through is initiative versus guilt. This happens during the preschool years between 4 to 5, and the constant question they ask themselves is it okay for me to do? At this age, children are very curious, they have a lot of questions around them, and parents often think that this is irritating and this is silly, and implicitly or explicitly they let the child know, and then the child feels guilt about asking those questions. Apart from that, since they start working in small peer groups, amongst themselves they start taking initiative. If this is encouraged, the child will continue to take initiative and feel very secure in leading others as well around them. However, if a child is controlled and criticized, the child may feel overtly dependent on others and may be very fearful at this point of time. Now, success at this stage leads to purpose, and purpose over here is basically defined as, do I understand the task at hand? Do I know what I want to do? And do I still know my limitations over here at this point of time? Now, there is a need to also feel some sort of guilt, otherwise the child will not have any sort of self-conscious or even self-control, okay? Okay. The next stage is that of industry versus inferiority, and this stage lasts from the age of 5 years to 12 years. And the big question that the child asks himself or herself is, can I make it in the world of people and things? At this stage, as you can see, children always want to try to please others. Their teachers and peers will be a very big influence in their life, and they want to complete tasks at hand. If a child is successful at this stage, he will feel industrious and very confident. However, if a child feels like he's not doing well and he's not meeting society's expectations, like for example being athletic, he may feel inferior about this. At the end of it, success at this stage basically leads to competence, and competence here is described as making things and creating results for themselves. Can we go to the next one? The next stage is that of identity versus role confusion, and this is a stage of adolescence which lasts between 13 to 19 years of age. And the big question the child asks himself or herself is, who am I and what can I be? This is a transition phase between childhood and adulthood, and it's extremely complex because the child starts asking questions about his or her role in society, things about work, responsibility, housing at this stage. They want a sense of self and they also want personal identity at this stage in their life. How do they do that? By deep digging into their values, beliefs and goals. Now, since identity exploration happens over here, I just want to tell you that identity exploration is a crisis between identity and identity diffusion. During adolescence, youth, they try to narrow down their explorations of sexual, relationship and occupational commitments at this stage of life. And identity diffusion happens if the person has not resolved any of this. For a very strong identity or a solid identity to develop, a person needs to have time away from the responsibilities of adulthood so that they can spend time in self-discovery. For example, there are a lot of adolescents that we also work with, and you must have seen that they get married at an early age or they take up full-time work very early in their life. What happens is that they, you will see that their fragility and immature behavior slightly later because they've still not formed their identity. No matter how a child has been raised, their personal ideologies can be very significantly different from their parents, and that's the reason during this stage, adolescents have a lot of conflicts with their parents regarding to how they live their life. Their personal and their religious ideologies may not necessarily match with each other. The other thing to note is nobody should be pushed into following a certain identity, because that automatically leads to negative identity and a feeling of like hopelessness and unhappiness around them. Success at this stage leads to fidelity, and fidelity here is being defined as commitment to society while still accepting the inconsistencies of value system that are present. One thing to note though is that though this stage is prescribed between 30 to 19 years, this stage can be very fluid because it does take some time for a person to be grounded in society and understand what is my sense of self. The next one is intimacy versus isolation. This is in your early adulthood and lasts anywhere between 20 years to 39 years. And the big question you start asking yourself is, can I love? You try to form intimate relationships with other people around you, especially if there is an overlap between, you know, I'm exploring my identity, but I also want to explore what does it feel like to be in a long-term commitment with another person who is not my family member. Now, some may not want to be in an intimate relationship because of the fear of rejection. They may feel that it causes a lot of pain if I am rejected. But if a person is successful at this stage and has a longer term commitment, his general state of mind is feeling happy, committed, safe and secure. However, if a person refrains from it because of the fear of rejection, that person may actually feel very isolated and unhappy. Success at this stage results into the virtue of love. Can we go back? I also want to highlight that overindulgence in intimacy also leads to promiscuity. There is a need of sexual desires while still being vulnerable. So that is also something that you need to keep in mind, the balance. The next stage of life is middle adulthood. This stage lasts anywhere between 40 to 65 years of age. And the question the person starts asking oneself is, can I make my life count? The person tries to create and nurture things around which will outlast them. For example, they will start taking care of their children. They will try to contribute back to society. If a person feels, you know, is successful at this stage, he or she may feel a sense of accomplishment, feels like they're contributing to the world when they're actually taking care of their kids and nurturing society. However, if a person does not do well at this stage, the general feeling is I'm unhappy and I'm unproductive as well. Now, success at this stage leads to virtue of care. I did some sort of snooping around to find out, does this really have like an impact? Like you're saying, at this age, you know, people start giving back to society. And Black Board, a fundraising organization which helps fund other organizations, conducted a survey in 2013. And what they found out was that 43% of their donor base was actually within this age group. The next stage is that of adulthood, and the phase is basically called ego integrity versus despair. Is it okay to have been me? The person at this age starts thinking about how have I lived my life, what accomplishments have I made. If they feel satisfied and if they're successful, they have integrity. And over here, integrity means coming to terms with how I've led my life, and I feel like I've led a well-lived life. However, if a person feels that I've not had a very good life, I'm not happy with my own actions, they will live in despair as well. Now, one thing to watch out for is also the ego integrity. If a person feels, does not have a realistic picture of exactly what are the challenges in their life, or maybe some actions have not been good, they may also be very pompous and arrogant. So, that is the balance that they need to maintain. Success at this stage leads to basically wisdom, and wisdom over here is defined as a sense of closure and completeness to life. They also at this point stop fearing from death. Now this stage can occur anywhere between, it may actually change the sequence because the person starts feeling of it is when they are actually nearing death. So if a person who is 30 years old knows that I am nearing death, he may go through this stage much earlier in life. Now we've gone through all the stages of the psychosocial development so far, and I think we will be spending some time now thinking about what are the factors that affect the psychosocial development. The first one is culture. Culture plays a very important role in how a person develops socially. Now, for example, in India, we know that women are married way early, right? Mm. And what happens because of this is they've not formed their identity completely. And this leads to immaturity and fragile behavior in their relationships. Especially if they're not sharing a very, very healthy relationship with their spouse. Since in India it's looked down upon that you cannot share it with somebody else, most of the times women, from social situations, they withdraw. Yeah. The second one is environment. That plays a very big role in the social development is that there are many communities which are prone to violence, gang rape, petty crime. And these people usually tend to don't feel secure around the other people. This insecurity because of the community around them actually passes to many other relationships that come their way even outside the community later on. There are a lot of kids who have also been a part of war and terrorism. And they express like their grief and nervousness and fear through many other ways, by acting up, by crying, by not talking to people, maybe by not eating and sleeping. This is how the environment plays a very big part even in social development. The role of a family. The role of a family plays a very crucial, the role of a family plays a very important part in social development. Secure attachments are formed with parents, and this basically helps us form better attachments with other people around us. There was a survey that was carried out between children in institutionalized homes as well as children who were reared at home. And the results said that 74% of children who have been reared at home have secure attachments with relationships that they have. However, children who are in institutionalized homes, only 20% of them actually had secure attachments to people around them. The other thing to note is that there's also preferred parenting style within the family that works best. Michael Bhumika has already spoken about it. And it is basically the authoritative and reciprocal style that works best because the child knows the expectations that has been laid by the parent, whereas at the same time, they're giving the child the opportunity to communicate to the parent actively. Teacher and peer relationships are fundamentally important because they form a source of inspiration and motivation. Even if these three are not very strong, a teacher can significantly change that social development in the child. And a lot of the social development also happens by interacting with other children and peers. The last one is temperament. Temperament is the biologically based levels of emotional and behavioral response. Researcher Jerome Kagan has proved that there are children who are born shy and born bold. And the children who are born shy were cautious and emotionally reserved, whereas the children who were born bold were sociable, effectively spontaneous, and minimally fearful in social settings. Now, though one's temperament does not change across time, but if you put in enough effort, you can basically change that about yourself. But it requires self-realization and concrete actions and steps towards that. The last thing that I wanted to talk about was, this is a very complex facet of human development, and I'm of course like still, looking forward to learn about this. And I just wanted to say that one thing that definitely that roots me into this even now is like my experience with my own children and seeing them growing up. I wish that I knew all of this right from the very beginning. But hopefully this experience will now help me design, the curriculum for the upcoming program that we're